Good morning, YouTube. How are you? Hope everybody is doing well. I had to put my music back on because I kind of missed my music. Because everywhere I go now in the spiritual community, somebody's playing music in the background of their videos. You go back at least 1 month, you don't see. 2 months, you don't see. 3 months, you don't see. So obviously they're watching my content. Everybody's doing it now. And I'm not throwing away what was for me just because they're all copying it. So here we are, back again. Obviously it was an amazing idea because it's emulating. I am used to being a trendsetter in this way. In my city, literally everything I did, people were doing poorly. So it is what it is. So I have three important things to talk about today. And the predominant thing that I want to talk about is spiritual hooks. Spiritual hooks. So I would call a spiritual hook something that a prayer needs to anchor onto in order for it to work. Now, prayers can be good or bad. Usually we associate prayers with prayers to the Most High God, and then we, I guess, tend to assume that prayers are going to be good prayers. There are bad prayers as well. What, you know, I've heard it called dark prayers. That's why I tell people, like, the Bible is also something that people can use for tools of, you know, just darkness, division, whatever have you. So, spiritual hooks. Spiritual hooks are physical actions that you can take. Anything that is done physically needs something spiritual on top of it as well. So you're basically fighting in the 3D and in the 5D. So you make a prayer and you say, I don't know, damn it, I want to be rich, but you do not work. Hell, you don't even steal. You don't do anything. You lay in bed all day. The chances of that happening are, I mean, maybe it has to be written in the stars like that for it to happen for you, but the chances are of that happening are little to none. Even spirit will tell you, we need you to do the work. So a spiritual hook is something that you must have in place for prayers to work. So even the Bible says faith without works is dead. So let's talk about spiritual hooks in terms of being gang stalked. One of the videos that I did before talked about entities as traits, personality traits. Personality traits manifest into behaviors. So you can see that people with particular behaviors are people that have some sort of possession or some sort of energetic, there's some sort of energetic hold over these people. So black magic, or any kind of magic, but we'll start with black magic, it needs behaviors or these hooks to hang on to. So I want to talk about when things are happening in your life and how they succeed spiritually. It's a bit too loud, let me turn it down. How do things succeed in your life spiritually? They need a hook. Say for example, someone is sending me energy to gain weight, which they always do, to be honest. They've been doing for a while. They've been doing that since the first time that it worked. And it worked in the very beginning when I was like, I wasn't paying attention, so much was going on. And that's another thing, is distraction. So people send work and then they distract you from taking care of it. So I wasn't paying attention at that time, and at that time it worked. And then I had to go through getting rid of the weight, and it took a lot because I wasn't spiritually cleaning it. I was doing the physical labor of cleaning it off. Now, normally when I start working out, within like, I'm not even joking, like a couple of months, it's like a transformation. This took a longer time. this took a longer time because it was also being combated with, they were still sending the work, but also if you're trying to clean spell work off with 3D work only, that's also like an uphill battle. It's like climbing uphill. And that's if nobody is reworking it on you. That is climbing uphill. So you're looking at somebody sending you this work, and then it has hooks so that you eat fast food, you eat a lot in general, you eat late at night, whatever the case is. As this is occurring, it has a hook on it that it can attach to. So if you are only going to gain a little bit of weight from that, or that was going to take a while to gain weight, the spell work amplifies it, so it happens much, much faster. That is what you got to think about, is the fact that it's going to happen much, much, much faster because there is a hook. If you're being sent spell work and there is no hook, the spell work cannot touch you. It might graze you even, but it's like a wobbly effect. It can't take a hold. It can't manifest in your life. So if they're sending you that energy and you are doing all the things that a normal person should do, you're working out, you're eating healthy, you're watching how your caloric intake, you're doing this, you're doing that, it's not gonna work. It's the spiritual hook that is needed. And that goes in every way, shape, or form. So say for example, let's say the spiritual hook is a behavior. Let's say, for example, you're a liar and somebody sends you spell work and they say, I want you to go to jail. If you're already a liar or you're a deceitful person, the hook is already ingrained. It's already built in. So the next time you go to lie, you get caught because you're already a liar. The next time you do something deceitful, you're getting caught. The hook is there. That is what spiritual hooks are. Let me give you a third example. Say you are already, maybe you're not a lustful person, but say for example, let's say you're celibate, but it's very difficult for you because it's coming to a point where it's very hard and you really, you're feeling like you want to scratch that itch, let's say. That's a hook. It's not that you're a lustful person, but the behavior, the whatchamacallit, oh my goodness, the capability is there, the possibility is there. There's something for it to attach to. So because you're already feeling that, if they send you an entity, the entity has something to latch onto. In a case like this, it's like, it's almost like the entity will have even more of a stronghold simply because there already existed the itch. So say somebody was already like, say a little bit promiscuous, but they already scratched that itch, let's say last week. They almost are in a better position than the person who's trying to be celibate. And this, there's like a hunger in them that there's just more. There's more for this entity to attach to. So when they compound that work on you, they're not gonna do it just one night. They're gonna continue doing it. And as they continue doing it, eventually it does hook because it just becomes too difficult to fight it. And so you can fight it on the 3D, you can, but it's gonna be hard. It's gonna be harder. It's gonna be very difficult. It's gonna take more prayer. It's gonna take more fasting. It's gonna take more work. It's gonna take more whatever it is, more willpower and more strength. This is why one of the videos I talked about strength versus strategy. You gotta try in spiritual warfare, in any kind of warfare, to conserve strength, because strength is a resource, just like money is a resource, just like manpower is a resource. Strength is a resource, and you're trying to conserve your strength. You're trying to conserve your energy. You're trying to conserve your life force as much as possible. You're trying to be very smart with the way that you dole out this energy. You don't want to deplete this, especially early on. So if you look at spirits as traits and you're looking at hooks, when people send you work, there are already, you got to look at the hooks that exist. And you got to first start by removing a hook, and then it's easier for spell work to be cleaned off. You can try to combat, let's say I'm going to go back to the weight gain. You can try to combat that all you want. You can do all the cleansing work. You can do all the prayers. You can fill the altar up with food as much as you want, with as many offerings, but there's hooks. So once they attach to the hook, it's like a hook. They attach to the hook. You're trying to break it like that. You're trying to break a hook. It could break. It could release. It could break with a lot of effort. Think about how much effort it takes to break a hook versus there's no hook and it's looking for something and there's nothing to catch to. So this is what you have to look at, and you got to address these things. So let me talk about, for example, with celibacy. If you're a person that has these feelings, I'm not saying necessarily lustful, but just has these feelings. When we look at things like celibacy, we're looking at celibacy is a tough thing to master in the beginning. In the beginning, celibacy is tough. So for me, celibacy was a full year, and then it gets difficult, maybe for a month or two, and then you could do the next year again. And then after the second year, it's like, it's whatever. After the third year, you could go a lifetime. It's no longer a need. It's no longer like, I'm not saying you have no more desire, you don't feel anything, but it's not a hook anymore. After your third year of celibacy, your fourth year of celibacy, it's like, are you even a sexual person anymore? Who knows? You could literally, I'm kidding, you could literally see something very graphic and it has no feelings for you. You're just like, okay. You know, even if you feel something, it's not a hook. It's not like how other people would feel it, because you've gone such a long stretch of time. We're not talking about 3 months. We're not talking about 6 months. We're talking about 4 years. That is a long time. Your body has adapted to that in a very serious way. So it's a very difficult practice on the onset, and it just becomes a lifestyle after that. So this is something that is very important to master in spiritual warfare, because the easiest way to defeat a spiritual person is through lust. It's the easiest way. It's like a point of entry where they send this energy, and then from this energy, everything else is just easier. It's easier to send you everything else. It's easy to control you. It's easy to fool you, to take your mind out of where it's supposed to be. Love magic works quick. Like, everything is a breeze once there's that energy of lust there. So there's that. The same way bad energy needs hooks, good energy needs hooks as well. So good prayers also need hooks. You pray, and then you go to work for what you prayed for. You pray, and then you go to work for what you pray for. So for example, you're saying, I want to lose weight. Now you got to add in the hooks. I work out. I eat healthy. I take care of myself. I watch what I eat. I watch the hours I eat. Many hooks you're putting in place. If you had just the workout hook, they could attach. Now you're adding the positive, like the good food hook. It attaches. Now you're adding watching what hour you eat. Third attachment. Now you're watching the caloric intake. Fourth attachment. There's so many hooks for it to attach to. So I call this giving spirit something to bless. I actually say giving God something to bless. I gotta give God something to bless. So when you're doing your spiritual work, it's all encompassing. You got the altar going. Spirit is taken care of. Not just because spirit wants to eat like we eat when we get hungry, but it's the energy from it. It's the earthly energy that spirit can attach to, can use to be closer to you. You say to Spirit, I want you closer. Spirit says, I want you closer. And so what they do is we keep on finding ways to be closer. Well, here's your offering. Well, here's some water. Well, here's some energy. Well, here's some prayers. Well, here's some chanting. Well, here's some loving words. Well, here's some staying together in communion. And when doing all of this together, you say, by the way, I kind of need this. Or Spirit tells you, why don't you have this? You need that. Because their job is to get you on your path. And when Spirit has this communication with you and Spirit says, well, you need to do this. And you say, yeah, I want it. And Spirit will say, I need a hook. I need a hook. You said you want to be, let's say, in a loving, happy relationship. But I have no hooks. You're a liar. You're not loving. You're not kind. Give me a hook because I can bring you someone, but you will push them away. You gotta take care of all of those things first. Remove those hooks to the opposite. Because if there's somebody here who wants to block you and they're saying, I don't want you in a loving relationship, the hooks you have are the lying, the cheating, the, you know, unkindness. You have hooks for negative energy, not hooks for positive energy. So you have to adjust your hooks and be very mindful of not working against the things that you want. There are people in gang stalking that do very confused work. They put a sweetening jar and then they attack you with the spell work. So they're blocking the jar. They're blocking the jar. They do a come to me spell in a cloak, but then at the same time, they work their hardest for you not to like that person. They do things to trigger you against that person, to make you hate that person, but they're in that person's cloak. There are people who are using spell work with no intelligence. So a lot of times people will ask, why is my work not working? Because the hooks are for the opposite. The hooks are not there. So let's look at love spells. A person might want to do a love spell on you, but they're not attracted to you. There is a first problem. You're not attracted to them. There is the second problem. You're not a vibrational match to them. Nothing can get over that problem. When you're not a vibrational match to a person, place, or thing, nothing is going to get over it. Nothing. Spirit can't even work with that. Let me tell you, just because they're spirits, just because it's the Most High God, does not change spiritual law and how things are supposed to work. Why would I do a video without light? It's like in the Bible, turning water into wine. I know it's a story, but like, let's be fair. You cannot get someone to be lustful for you even, and there's no physical attraction either way. No attraction. The sex magic won't work. The love spell won't, nothing will work. Now, when you add in two people who dislike each other with a passion and an intensity, and then you add in, as a final little cherry on the top, spiritual warfare and spell work that is going against the target, we might as well just take the love spell and get it off the altar. What is this? The entity that these people are working with is probably looking at it like, brother, what is this? What are you giving me to do here? What do you want me to do with this? This person hates you. This person is disgusted by you. This person is blocking you out of their energy. It won't work. So you have to see it the same way when it comes to your prayers for what you want out of your life. You said to Spirit, you go on your knees every night. I want to address how prayer works. because there's some of us who say spirit is not working in our favor. Okay, you said to spirit, I want to get out of gang stalking. I prayed, and God didn't come. Actually, God was right there beside you listening to the prayers because your heart was pure. You were in the right position. And so the first box was already there. Number one, were you a vibrational match to what you were asking for? You asked to be released from gang stalking, but you behave as a slave. You behave as one who should be controlled. You behave as one who is not in control over your own life. You behave as one who's always scared and running and doesn't stand your ground. So there's number one. Number two. I like the music I like. Number two, are you doing the work? We need hooks. I don't want to be a TI, but you have no hooks. You only have hooks for being a TI. You don't have hooks for not being a TI. You talk about being a TI all day. You hyper obsess about things that have to do with being a TI. Everything you identify as a TI, you call yourself a TI. You don't even call yourself an ex-TI, you call yourself a TI. So all the hooks are for being a TI. The mentality is for being a TI. The vibrational match is to a TI. People who are not a vibrational match to TIs do as they please. They do not follow direction. They do not behave as a TI. They do not identify as a TI, and they do not hyperfixate on these things as being a TI. That's why I talk about now, it's time to move on. It's time to move on from being a TI. Vibrational match and the hooks. Now let's talk about the work. You're sitting there and you're sitting in a position where every day you're praying that it won't work. Yet you're doing all the things that they want you to do. If they want you to wake up at this time, they want you to go onto the street at this time and go watch people, and they want you to do all of this, you're participating as a TI gang stalker. Because to me, it's the same thing. A targeted individual and a gang stalker is the same thing, whether they know it or not. Their life is in the hands of these people, of these organizations. So their destiny's in the hands of these organizations, their life contract, their soul contracts are in the hands of these organizations. What work are you doing to give the spirit to say, I'm gonna work with you to combat this thing that I'm saying that I don't want to exist in my world? Where's the work that I'm gonna give you? And if you're not giving spirit work, you're not giving some spirit something to work with, then it's like spirit going to court on your behalf and you're the star witness and you're not there. You don't show up to court. You have no idea what's going on. How on earth are we gonna get this case won and you're not here and you're not doing the work? You got to do the work. A lot of times what happens is we're scared to do the work and we think God is going to do the work for us, and it cannot be. It cannot happen. Spirit can only bless and sweeten already what is happening with you. So for example, I used to pray for sales at my store, and we used to have to go in and not just work hard, talk to people as they come in, coax people, show people the goods. The goods gotta be worthy of being purchased. The goods gotta be beautiful. And then they have to be properly displayed and properly priced. I'm giving them more hooks. Properly displayed, proper lighting, proper everything. And then I do proper pricing. Then I gotta do the marketing. I need people to come in. I gotta let people know that I'm there. I gotta have a nice Instagram page, a nice whatever page I used to market, a nice website. Well, we didn't back then, but you know, we needed something. And then when they come in, I can't be in an energy of desperation because that's the wrong vibrational match. I gotta make this thing fun, upbeat, the place to be, the right music, the right attitude. And some, and you know, because I was targeted, it was hard to get staff, so I had to get, we had to figure it out ourselves. And so where we're falling short, we got to do the best that we can do to pull it up. We got to dress appropriately, dress the part, but we also have to be in the right mood. When people come in, we're already upbeat, we're already having a good day. So instead of sitting there and being in a downer mood and depressed, we got to be like having a good day. And so when you have those bad days, they send you anxiety, they send all the dirty energy, the spell work to the store. You got to clean the spell work off. You got to clean off through the store. You got to make sure everything looks nice, nicely vacuumed. Lights are on, everything. And then we got to get into this mood. I come in and I'm seeing the girls and they're looking stressed. We haven't made any money. And I'm like, hey, let's get the mood up. Go to the food court, go get you some food, go for a walk, go have a good time and come back. And when they come back, it's like the music is already going. So whether or not you're in the mood, the music will catch you. It'll put you, the beat of it already will put you in the mood. That's why a lot of people, they chant to music. They chant to particular music because the music gets you going. It puts you in the vibration by itself. It pulls you in. And so you have that going already and you're, you know, you might have been saying something and the beat just drops and it catches you. And then you're like, now the angels can catch that energy. They can catch it. They pull it and they're waiting on you and they're waiting on that and they grab it. And they pull in that energy, boom, someone walks in at the right moment. And when they walk in and everything is already set, the stage is already set, they like it. They like your attitude. They like everything that's happening here. They like the attitude, they like the money, they catch the spirit. And then they're like, you know what? I didn't come here to spend this money, but I need this. I needed this anyway. This is how you do things in a positive way. This is not black magic. This is not dark work. This is not going against the will of someone, because the stage could be set and everything could be great and someone walks in and they don't have the money. There's nothing we can do. Somebody walks in and they don't need it. There's nothing we can do. So you have to set the stage and let spirit do that part. Let that person who needed it think, let me go to the mall, go get a hot dog. Let me go to that mall because that's the only one that has like the thing that I like. And so they end up here and then they tell you the story. You know, I only came here because I just wanted one of those hot dogs that they have in the food court. And then something just told me, let me walk around. And I actually need this. We used to have people literally crying because they could see themselves in their engagement dress that they got from us. They could see themselves in their prom dress. So it wasn't just a purchase, it was a passionate purchase. And now an energetic cord has formed between us because now they like what you offer. They feel like they're getting a good buy. They're getting something, not just what the price that they're paying for it, but they also like what they're supporting. We had people of every gender, race, shape, size, whatever, come in and say, you know, I love the fact that I'm supporting you guys because we can see that you guys are a young business. I did it all the time. There were other stores that we would go to and it's like, there was one particular store, I could see people laughing at them. People were just downing them a lot. And you know, it's like, we just would walk in there and it's like, you know, if somebody I was with would try to laugh, I'd be like, shut up. This is hard work. This is scary stuff too. And on top of it, I would also say to them, you know what? Let me see if there's something. I'm walking around looking for something to buy. Why? Because the vibrational output that they're putting is that they're trying their best. And so maybe the stage isn't set properly. Maybe it's not styled the best way. Maybe there's not the best stuff in there. But the vibration is we're honest, we're hardworking, we're trying our best. And so that's what I wanted to. That's where my energetic cord with them would come from, is from helping them. So you have to be an energetic match with the things that you want. Because if you are not an energetic match, nothing is gonna work. You could put that person's face, who you're trying to attack, on 25 altars in 25 countries with the 25 top spiritualists in the world. It will come, the energy will generate, it will be blocked every time. It is not an energetic match. It's a mismatch. It won't work. It won't work. You need prayers and then you need behaviors. And then when all of that's done, you want to sweeten it even more. You start perfecting it. You start perfecting every single thing that you can. Give spirit clean work. And if you're close with your guides will say, I see what you did, but it's you gotta rework that. Take it down, redo it. I don't like it. They need to get you to your path. They need to get you to where you're supposed to go. This will not work. We gotta do something else. We gotta do it a different way. And so that's how it works. So you wanna talk about light work, dark work, all of this. Sometimes I think work is work. It's just, what is your intention behind it, really? Everything follows the same rules. Everything follows the same rules. It needs to be an energetic match. So say, for example, somebody's doing a love spell on you and they're a treacherous human being. If you're a treacherous human being, you'll feel attracted to what you see. If they're a lustful person and you're a lustful person, it will bond like glue. But if you're the total opposite of that, it won't work. It won't work. Now, staying in a high vibration and staying in a place of positive karma and staying in a place where you're a good person, all of that assists you because you're only an energetic match to a positive person. So sometimes maybe you might want something, a particular person, whatever, but you're not an energetic match yet. The work cannot go through until you are an energetic match, until you can meet people where they are. So I'm not advocating spell work, but I'm teaching you about energy work because if you're a TI, you're now in a place of energy work. If you do not understand energy, nothing's gonna work. You don't even know how much you don't know. Like, you don't even know. You'll be overwhelmed by how much you don't know. So, because you need to perfect something, let's tie this to destiny swapping. When somebody takes your destiny, a major part of this is stopping you from fulfilling your destiny. Two people cannot exist at once. There's the originator, and then there's the copy. The originator, the original looks extremely different than the copy. It feels different, it tastes different, it sounds different. My messages will sound different because they come from me, from my heart, and they come from spirit. So even the whole platform is a marriage with spirit. These are messages from spirit, voicing what spirit wants to say. I'm not making this up. I'm not cultivating it. Spirit will give me the messages in multiple different ways, but this is from spirit, what spirit wants everybody to know. People who take the message and regurgitate it it's not coming from the experience. It's not coming from the hardship, from the strife. It's not coming from spirit. So if I continue to exist and they continue to exist, people can come here and they can come there and they're like, this one is sweet. That has no flavor. Doesn't matter if it's the exact same words and spoken in the exact same way. It's the energy that cannot be duplicated. And if I don't exist and they don't have the messages, then they can't move forward with it either way. They can make it up for a time being, but it doesn't matter. They need the original in order to take this thing. And I said years before, spirit will not work with these people. So this kind of contract was just like, it was like a trap to take. It lacked common sense to try to take something like this. And if you're looking at things like, you know, sometimes it's like you got to perfect your work. Not sometimes, every time you got to perfect your work. That's why they try to block the perfection stage. Because let me tell you, the perfection stage is where you build your hooks. So if they block you from building your hooks, then it's like, then they're trying to block spirit from having something to bless. So let's say if it's a business and your business is you guys install lights in a very fancy, no, that's not a good one. Let's say you're an artist and you need to perfect your techniques. In the perfecting stages where they make it very hard for you to perfect, so those hooks are not there. But once that perfection is there, if nobody knows you, but the work is beautiful, The work is clean. The work is amazing. All spirit needs is that to be perfected. Now you give that work to spirit, spirit can start throwing you into people's face. The right place you need to be, success is guaranteed. This was on your path anyway. This is the thing about your destiny. Once you stop, what can we hook to? What can we attach to? You've stopped your growth, you've stopped your evolution, you've stopped your perfection, your perfecting. There's nothing that we can attach to. We need to make sure that you give something to spirit to bless, something for spirit to attach everything to. Because if spirit takes this and tries to blow it up in its condition, you're going to be a laughingstock and you're just going to be blocked. There's nothing here to attach to. It's not good. And these people are trying to block you so you don't get what you want. So they're not going to, they don't want anyone to see what you're doing, even if it's rough, even if it's raw. They want you to stop altogether because they want to take it and go. And the only other way that they will allow it to blossom is if their hand is in it. If it can blow up, but we need our people to be in there in some way, and through that person that we can benefit off of it financially. So this is what happens with destiny swapping. The prayers catch the perfection and then spirit allows it to launch. The other thing is, when it's not ready, spirit will block it from launching. Spirit will block it from blowing up. Spirit will block it from, sometimes you think it's other people and it's spirit using other people so that it doesn't blow up. So you got to consider all of these factors when you ask yourself, why am I not getting the things that I'm supposed to get? Because it needs more work. And it doesn't matter what you're praying for. You can pray to have good friendships and you're not a good friend, not going to work. You can pray to whatever it is you pray for, really. If you are not a vibrational match, this will not work. You need to be a vibrational match to the things that you ask for energetically. So, if we reverse engineer everything that I'm saying, in order to block spell work, you need to eliminate hooks as well as having prayer. Simple. So you know what kind of spell work that is coming your way because of the kind of things that are trying to manifest in your life outside of your behaviors. You want to block the spell work. Yes, you need to actually, like, you need rituals. You need cleanses. You need behaviors. You need vibration. You need all of it. That is the work. As a TI, they have you energetically bound up. So you got to figure out, what are the hooks that I need to dispel out of my life in order for me to energetically detach from this? If you are a TI and you think that God's gonna come and save you from being a TI without you doing the work, I'm gonna tell you, no siree, it's not gonna happen, not even for the best of us. The energetic and spiritual hooks are in place. I have been working on mine for 2 years and it's gonna take whatever amount of time it takes. You gotta learn the lessons. Spirit's not gonna come and tell you, here is your manual of lessons to learn. There are 10 things on here. Complete these 10 things and you can go. No, you got to experience it. You got to go through it. You got to do the work. That means you got to get gang stalked even harder. You're going to get spell work even harder. You're going to get everything even harder before it gets easier, before it works. And that's life. That's how it works. Positive spirits are not in the business, like you pray to God and high vibrational spirits. They are not in the business of changing people's willpower, because that is breaking spiritual law. This cannot and does not occur. They do not possess people. They do not change anything. They do not cultivate feelings in people that are not there. They can only sweeten what you ask for and where your vibration is. You must be requesting this. You must be the manufacturer of the energy. They're not going to cultivate your energy for you. So as you stay in your fight, as you show commitment, as you show determination, as you change your vibration, then it happens. You got to change the fear. You got to change living as a slave. You got to change following people's directions as if they are lording over you. You got to stand in your power. You got to learn how to do things. All of it must come together. And sometimes it takes a while. So many things need to come together, need to happen in a particular order in order to get you out of here. So you just got to start your journey. Don't even worry about that. Don't worry about how long. You got to start your journey. You got to start your walk and to emancipate yourself from energetic slavery, from spiritual slavery. None but ourselves can free our mind. Spirit can't do it for you. You got to do it yourself. I talk about blocking access. And before I get to this, I want to explain something because I know my messages reach people. This one, maybe they might not want to reach people, but I know my messages reach people that sometimes need to hear it. Let me explain something. One of the reasons why, if not the predominant reason why, I cannot be in whatever organization this is because I can't visualize it. I can't see it. I would prefer to die. I would prefer to be poor. I would prefer to lose everything than to be a part of this. So much so that I had to. I was okay. It was a welcome idea to me. You gotta be willing to lose everything in order to get out of here. Because if I can't see it in my mind, I can't manifest it. And so I'm not a vibrational match to the place, to the people, to anything there. If I can't see it, it can't occur. I can never see myself on a plane doing that. So it cannot occur because I cannot manifest it. It doesn't matter how many altars they put me on, what they do, I can't see it. Now, if you're a person who's been in there and you're not willing to lose everything because that is how it works, that is a spiritual law. You have to lose everything in order to leave. If you are not willing to lose everything in order to leave, I didn't say lose some things, I said lose everything. I'm telling you the truth because this is the truth. It was revealed to me for a reason, so I can tell you. If you want to make it even faster, you gotta give it up. Once everything is out of your hands, then spirit is able to energetically start the work that needs to be started, and not a moment before. Gotta get rid of everything. You gotta get rid of everything. Let's talk about what everything means. Everything means everything. The friendships, the lovers, the relationships you built, anything you built while in there gotta go. The property, the money, especially the money, everything. Everything is everything. The only thing that they cannot touch and affect is what they didn't have their hands in. So before you got involved in this, whatever this was, this curse, this family, whatever happened before their time, they cannot energetically affect or touch. But whatever happened during their time, whatever their money's mixed in, yeah, no, you can't. There's nothing you can do about that. You gotta walk away from that clean and clear. You gotta walk in away from that. And that is what it is. Now, you might wanna burn it off, but you're gonna burn it off while you're in there. So you might say, I wanna burn it off, but they want it to fall out of your hands all at once. So you might maybe wanna live off of these resources, but you're doing it while in there. The only way you're walking out is with nothing at all. Soon as that happens, spiritual binding can break. spiritual binding cannot break while you continue to work with them, while you continue to hold on to the money and all that. Now, the predominant reason why people do not want to leave these organizations is because they know they're gonna have to start from scratch, ground zero, depending on how much they took from these people. So if you took quite a bit from these people, then yeah, you're gonna have to start from ground zero. But you know, it depends on how fast you wanna get the hell out of there energetically. Because they're depleting you. It's not a one-way street. They have their hand in everything that you do once you're in there. Whatever you produce, whatever you birth, they're gonna have their hand in. Because the way that they get you in there is with multiple hooks. Hooks can be children, hooks can be spouses, hooks can be property, business, jobs, friendships. They got you surrounded with social influences. These are hooks. So you gotta get rid of all your hooks. I'm talking dentist, the family doctor, the freaking plumbers, everything that you deal with, you gotta let it all go. Everything will be affected. And it just is what it is. It's a tough thing, but it just is what it is. You know, things that you got before you got there, these are the things that they can't touch. But things that they put in your hand, or they influence, or they put their hands in, yeah, that's a no-go. So if you want to be an energetic match with leaving, you got to be willing to lose everything, and you got to not be able to see yourself there. I never see myself working with these energies. I cannot visualize it. I cannot see it. I reject it. I have never considered it. Not an energetic match. Don't like them. They don't like me, with passion on both sides, etc., etc. Never going to work. Spiritually, it cannot work. So that leads me to my second point, blocking access. Blocking behaviors, blocking hooks, blocking them from accessing your home is a major, major, major key. It's a major one. If they can access your home, then they can curse what you got going on. No progress can make sense if there's access to your home, because everything you do, somebody is from the inside cursing it. It's being cursed from the inside. What on earth is this? Everything you do is being cursed from the inside. So you gotta block the access. You will experience a level of peace, a crazy level of peace, just by being able to pull yourself away from these people energetically and blocking their physical access to, not physical, but their energetic access to your home. That's number one. All these candles that you want to burn to like purify your space are working overtime when somebody's coming in every single time you do work and cursing it. So you must understand that. Blocking access to your information. When people couldn't get people to be friends with me, they just hacked me. And so when they know what you're coming up to and what you're trying to do, then yeah, they got something that they can work with in order to either try to get in to work against you or to block it. Access to your emotions and your reactions, you gotta block that. You gotta be able to glide over nonsense. You're gonna need that skill for the rest of your life, not just with gang stalking, for the rest of your life. So you gotta be able to deal with that. And then you need access, you need to be able to block access to your body. If they can't, listen, they're gonna keep going down the checklist. I'm gonna tell you right now, they're gonna keep going down the damn checklist. They're gonna start with accessing your home, using your home like a train station, all kinds of witches are hopping in and out of your space. Astral projection. If they can't do that, because they can't, and they can't access your energy because the spiritual binding broke, they're gonna astral project in and out as they see fit. When that doesn't work, then they're gonna try to access you by sending like spell work and negative energy. When that doesn't work, then they're going to try to use fire magic on your body. Make you gain weight, make you gain pimples, make this happen, make that happen, make your hair break, make blah, blah, blah. When that doesn't work, they're going to try something else. And when that doesn't work, they're going to try something else. And your job is to continue to learn how to block access. Just because you don't have a solution today does not mean you're not going to have a solution tomorrow. You must continue to do the work of blocking the access from you. It is not something that you're doing just for your comfort. It is something you're doing to enable positive movement forward in your life. It is important. So you gotta put hooks in place for your spirit team to be able to anchor in. Yes, we wanna anchor in the home, but this place is being accessed by so much negative energy and so much things are not working in here. And as you block access, not just to your home, not just to your body, not just to all your mind and your reactions, you start seeing positive things can finally begin to occur and flow in. But it is important to block the access. And these are the kind of things that I talk about and the kind of things you have to learn. I'm not always going to give people recipes, antidotes, and all of that. Now that you know that you have a spiritual journey, you and your guides can work together because your attacks are going to be different from my attacks. The person working on you is going to have a different temperament than the person working on me. Different character, personality, persistence, etc. The last thing that I want to talk about is spiritual favor. Spiritual favor is so, it's the most important thing that a human being can have. First of all, some of us are just born with spiritual favor over our life for whatever reason, you know, multiple reasons, I'm sure. When you have spiritual favor, you usually probably have spiritual gifts as well. When you have spiritual gifts in addition to your spiritual favor, when you have spiritual gifts in addition to your spiritual favor, you are in a very positive situation. I think that's the best situation that anybody could be in, to be honest with you. I don't think one has to come with the other, but it usually probably means that there's some spiritual purpose over your life. There's something that you have to do for the spirits. They bless you for a reason. If you come into this life with spiritual favor, you come into this life with spiritual favor, you're probably going to have a very tough life. I'm talking about spirits of light favor you. That means spirits of darkness already know that whatever you're coming here for is going to be against them. Because these two energies, they are opposed in their motives. Spirits of light want to uplift people, help people, and free people. And spirits of darkness want to bind people and enslave people and block their path. No path do people want to block more than a spiritual path. You think that they're aggressive when you have a path of making money? Wait till you have a spiritual path. Boy, they will put you under spiritual attack night and day. The thing is, this is the path to enlightenment. The attacks are on your path. Spirit knows how these people are, so I don't want to say they orchestrate the spiritual attacks, but in a way it can feel that way. It can feel like they're saying, first of all, spirits of light are genius energy. This is the energy of the universe. This is the energy of knowledge. This is the energy of infinite knowledge, infinite wisdom. Why would you not want to work with this energy? Working against this energy is working against yourself. So it's like spirit will use them and all their attacks to put you on your path. It's almost like spirit saying, why would I push you or bully you? I love you. Let's just step out of the way when we need to step out of the way so something can push you where you need to go. So whenever you have a path of healing people, spirit doesn't tell you how to heal people. Spirit shows you what it is that people are feeling with this condition, with this ailment. So spirit allows you to taste of the ailment. somebody is sending me a skin condition, weight gain, or whatever, spirit was saying, okay, well, that's what's gonna happen to you. And you're like, damn, I need to clean it off. I need an antidote. Well, you gotta find your antidote, and then it has to work. The balance is not right. The formula is not right. This is not right. That is okay. You gotta perfect it. And then when it perfects, then you can help other people. Prior to that, you cannot. Can't do anything for anyone until you know how to do for yourself. And you can't take people's ailments and concerns seriously until you've endured it yourself. Somebody comes to you, you cannot be able to have compassion for them when you've never gone through it yourself. You don't know what it feels like. And then after you know what it feels like, your compassion is greater. Your capacity for compassion is there. I cannot talk to people about gang stalking until I've endured gang stalking. After I've endured it, I can say, and I can know what to say and what not to say. I'm not gonna tell somebody who's gone through gang stalking, just get over it or this and that. I can't, because I understand where it comes from. I understand why they feel that way. I feel compassion. And so that's why you're put through situations to heal people, to help people, is you must endure it. So let's give, for example, we learn through adversity or tragedy. And that tragedy is a catalyst for our evolution. It is a catalyst for change. It's not just, I know what it's like. No, it's a catalyst for you to evolve. What is an evolution? An evolution is taking something that was and changing it, enhancing it, building it, making it better. You are not supposed to be the same after something like that happens to you. The tragedy. So spiritually, we look at tragedies as a gift. We look at gang stalking as a gift. It is an evolution. It is a death and rebirth process. It is an initiation, and it is an ascension. Every tragedy evolves you. I used to be that way, but now I'm this way. I used to be materialistic, petty, this, that, and the third, but something happened to me to show me that's not a good way to be. And so I had to step back and I had to evolve out of that. I can't be this person for these reasons. So this is why spirit doesn't tell you. Some people want to hear spirit as a voice, but spirit doesn't have to verbatim tell you. Spirit will teach you. Spirit will walk you through. Sometimes spirit brings you somewhere to show you. It's almost like energetically you feel spirit pointing. Do you see? Do you see the suffering of others? Do you see what they're putting up with? Do you see what they have to fight? Do you see why they live this way? Do you see why they behave this way? So that's why you get the tragedy. This is saying versus feeling. Saying versus enduring. And then when you're done all of that, and you face that adversity, then you must face the healing. That is where the evolution happens, is in the healing. First, you face the tragedy. And the tragedy is not meant to say spirit is not there. No, spirit is even closer to you in your tragedy, because this is your path and you gotta make it through. Spirit is right there with you while you're being gang stalked, believe it or not. Spirit sees that you're crying, that it hurts, that you are screaming for a solution. Spirit's right there. But your anger, your low vibrational feelings, your feeling of not believing in spirit blocks spirit from you, blocks the communication, blocks the ideas, blocks the hope, blocks the motivation. That's why we pray so consistently. We meditate so consistently. We reach out to God so consistently. Let me tell you something about prayer. Spirits communicate with energy, so you don't even need words for prayer. Did you know? You don't even need words. They don't give you words, but they communicate with you. Some prayers are just laying down in front of your altar. Sometimes I lay in front of the altar like a four of swords. I don't even have the words. I just lay there, but they interpret what I'm feeling in that moment. Sometimes I'm ecstatic. I'm so happy. I start one sentence and then I I'm like squealing and I can't even finish the idea, and but they catch that energy. They know exactly what it is I mean, what I'm saying, what I'm feeling. They interpret it. Prayer is not always words. You can just sit there in sadness, in grief, crying. You go to your altar, and as you sit at that altar, they also understand that. You may be angry, you whatever it is that you're feeling, they understand all of it. And as you're sitting there and you're experiencing that, you're giving that to them and you're saying, I don't know what to do with this. Sometimes it's in the middle of prayer that I get the relief from whatever it is that I'm feeling, and I leave the prayer feeling light, feeling amazing. They took that energy from me. So your altar is not, you don't need fancy prayers. And when you teach your children and you teach other people to pray, if that's something that you're ever gonna do, and I pray that you do, I say to people, talk to God. Talk to God. If you're coming from a street lifestyle, I'm giving an example, and you speak a certain way with slang and whatever, just speak to God like that. Don't try to like pray like a preacher. There's no point in doing that. God has been listening to you speak to everybody else like that. You just speak the way that you speak, and you say what you say, and you might want to stop swearing. They'll tolerate it for a bit, and then eventually they'll say, you gotta change how you speak. You gotta stop swearing. You gotta stop this. You gotta stop that. Because what happens is, once you cultivate the relationship, they cultivate you. You open your life. You open your mind. You open your world. You open yourself energetically, and now we can come in here and like kind of rearrange things so that we can help you help yourself. So slowly but surely, I told you, when God comes in your life, you just start feeling the need to change things. Eating better, taking care of yourself, doing different things. It changes automatically because they incite that in you. Like, I'm praying, but I smoke all the time. Or I do these things, or I go to these places or whatever. And let me not say you can't smoke. So let me use another example. Whatever it is, Spirit will tell you how Spirit wants you to groom your own life. Don't take it from me, please. Spirit will tell you how to groom your own life. And Spirit communicates with energy. Whether it's spirit of dead people, spirits of entities, God, whoever, energy. Energy is something that cannot be faked. Dark energies cannot fake love. They cannot fake peace. They cannot fake it. Their energy speaks for itself. It comes in. It's aggressive. It's hateful. It's vile. It's jealous. Doesn't matter how you try to love bomb and fake it, the energy is what you feel. So if you're a translator of energy, meaning that you're a person that likes to work with spirit, you feel energies very, you're very sensitive to all kinds of energies. So you might have, and this happened to me, and a promise is a promise, so I do want to mention this, but you might have an energy come to you, and it might be a smiling energy, but the energy you feel is of sadness. It's of grief. Even though the energy wants to come in a smiling way, it wants to come in a way to say, I'm coming in peace, but what it is vibrating is sadness and grief and pain and loss. And that's the energies that are around gang stalking, the people who've passed, is they're in a vibration of sadness and of grief. And if those energies, those passed on people, those ancestors, now they've been made into ancestors prematurely, go into the energies of the people who have taken them out of here, that is the energy that they're bringing with them. And if they decide to sit in your space, that's the energy that you're gonna have. It doesn't matter what you wanna do, what you wanna think, what you wanna have. They're coming with an energy of loss. They're coming in an energy of grief. They're coming in an energy of desolation. They're coming in an energy of vengeance, of wanting vengeance, of wanting justice. And that energy will permeate in your space, and this is not something that you can get rid of, because it is a vibrational match. You can burn whatever it is that you want to burn. I'm telling you, vibrational matches. A vibrational match is quite frankly one of the strongest things that you can have. That's why your heart chakra needs to open first before you can talk to spirit, before you can welcome spirit, because spirit has to live in that heart chakra. And if they are not a vibrational match to you, meaning that you're not feeling love or you do not have the capacity to feel love, because let's face it, you can't be in the same vibration 24 hours a day consistently. You're gonna have little wobbles, little bumps. You learn how to control it and to remain consistent, but it's, you're a human being, you're gonna have loss, you have to transcend that. You're gonna have things that happen, you have to constantly transcend those feelings. But when you are not an energetic match to spirit, you can't access spirit, so there's nothing there. Where is spirit gonna go? In a blocked heart, in a hateful heart, it can't go, it can't reach you. So you must open this up, not just to love one or two people or people who are close to you, but universal love. Universal love is the language of spirit. Let's go back to spiritual favor. People with spiritual favor over their life, with particular things in their destiny, they will go through tragedy, heartache, heartbreak. Very tough things. People think that spiritual favor is just, oh, I'm gonna get a lot of money, I'm gonna be lucky, I'm gonna be this, I'm gonna be that. No, not necessarily. You might be the one that ends up homeless, persecuted. Look at Jesus, the story of Jesus, born in a manger, sleeping with the animals outside of the inn. A life, an impoverished life, a life of persecution, and then murdered. This is a life of being in favor. It doesn't work the same way for everyone, not every lifetime. So you get this adversity and your really spirit pushes you to heal, pushes you to forgive. Listen, I could tell you this right now. A lot of my healing is because spirit has pushed every day. You gotta heal, you gotta heal, you gotta heal, you gotta address it, you gotta address it. And it's like, oh my gosh. And because spirit is so persistent, you don't have a choice. You gotta go through. You don't have a choice, because even if you try to ignore it and say, yeah, you know, I'm gonna move on to something else because this one's hard, it's gonna be put in your face. You're gonna be minding your business and all of a sudden here comes a bad memory. All of a sudden here it comes and it's knocking you down and you gotta address it. And spirit will know when you're healed. Spirit will know when you're ready. And you'll know, because the same trigger will come again and it will not affect you. It will have no effect. It just won't work. The same trigger that's always worked, it just will not work. And you want to get it to that point where it doesn't work. So it starts off where it debilitates you. It might even pull down your energy, be very heavy. And then it gets to the point where it's like you experience the trigger and you're like, oh, well, at least I didn't break down and not be able to like continue my day because I was so hit by this. And then it gets to the point where you're like, oh, okay. And you can just get over it a lot easier. And that's when you know the healing work is working and the shadow work is working, is that you no longer need to. Sometimes you might be at the point where, and with a lot of us, it doesn't mean you're not healed, where you just don't want to address it. It's kind of like dabbling in behavior that you don't want to have. So if you don't want lustful behavior, then why would you watch porn? So if you know that there are things that are going to trigger you in the wrong direction, then you just don't participate in it. It doesn't mean that you're weak to it. It means that you're grooming your mind, grooming your heart, and staying on the direction of healing and not regressing. So you have to heal. You have to forgive those who hurt you. Hard. In gang stalking, they don't want you to forgive them. As soon as you say that you forgive them, they're gonna start on you again. So this is a very difficult one. Forgiving people who refuse to let you forgive them. But in the forgiving is how you transmute the energy. You take that energy of hatred and you put that energy into something else, into more positive vibrations. Easy? No. They're not making it easy, but necessary. And that is the work. So you're forgiving for yourself, not for other people, and you're transmuting as much as possible. That is how you step into your destiny. All of this work has to get done. You're not skipping any of these steps, and no matter if you want to or not, this is work on every level. It's physical work, it's emotional work, it's energetical work, it's spiritual work, it's working with spirit, it's all of it. But that's what you get guides for. They know what, they know when. They will warn you, they will shake you, they will push you. And you'll be like, why do I have to like face this? Because you have to. You gotta heal all these betrayals and all the pain, and you gotta see everything you see. And you gotta get to a point where people betray you and you don't hold it against them. You're like, you know what, maybe that's their path, their lesson. Maybe they're not capable, whatever it is. You gotta see it from a higher perspective. And it's not always easy in gang stalking, because my God, is it difficult. Sorry. If you neglect this work, it comes to a point you start missing your critical marks, and then spirit has no choice but to abandon you because you're going the wrong way completely. You're going the complete wrong way. And that is something that needs to be addressed at all times. You need to make sure that you're meeting spirit halfway with where spirit's telling you to go, regardless of the fact that it's not easy, because we know that it's not easy, but you gotta meet spirit halfway. So you can get to a point that you're so far off your path that the spirit will just step aside because there's nothing they can do. You won't listen, you won't heal, you won't forgive, you won't do the work, you won't get up and try to walk away, you won't. It's too far gone, it's beyond saving. And that is where you lose favor completely. A lot of the times I really believe that we're given these tragedies to be able to help other people, heal other people, and understand other people. So I might think it was a mistake that when I was younger, I was atheist, but that was meant to be on my path, because now I understand people who are atheists. I understand where it started, how it started, and I understand what they're going through, that they've come to this place. I get it. I have sympathy, I have compassion, and I have empathy because I've been there. I understand people who've been gang stalked because I've been there. The empathy, the capacity I have to empathize is massive. So even when somebody who's been gang stalked may behave in a way that other people may find to be all kinds of things, maybe irrational, maybe they're hurt, they're bitter, they're angry, I empathize with it all. I felt it all. They're hateful. I felt it all. I might think, my goodness, well, why was I hateful at one point? That's the wrong way to be. But no, that's on your path. You gotta go through that. You gotta feel it, and you gotta feel why. And then you gotta feel how hard it is to transcend out of that feeling into a place of forgiveness, into a place of peace. Because if I don't know how difficult it is, I'm gonna judge somebody for not getting out of this place of hatred. So this is why I gotta go through it, see what drives a person to be hateful, and then to transcend out of it. That is the work. Spirit could wanna gift you the best contract you've ever had in your life, but you're not a vibrational match. So say, for example, you went through some trauma in your life that you didn't heal from, and Spirit gave you a year or two as an opportunity for you to heal that massive hurt. Then you could have come on the path with helping others heal, but you refused to do it. And so in your refusing to do it, Spirit took away the contract and has now had to give it to someone else, because the path is the path. People need healing. Some of these things are so difficult to heal from. But if you don't do the work, it cannot get done. If you did not do the work, how can you help other people do the healing? It cannot be done. And spirits can reject all spiritual contracts with just cause. Spirits can, it's not just that they're rejecting it, it's like it cannot work. It's like metaphysically impossible. There are a lot of things that are metaphysically impossible. That is what they call spiritual law. They find ways to like break your will and do all of that kind of stuff, right? But even in these situations, I'll say it's not your will that they're breaking. It's just that they're putting in so much adversity on your path that you feel like they're breaking your will. But technically, it's metaphysically impossible to break your will. Like, they can beat down on me as much as they want, but if I choose not to do something, it will never happen. I must choose to do it. I must be in alignment with it. I must be in agreement with it. If I'm not in agreement with it, then I fight it. And spirit supports me in that fight. It cannot work. There are things that are metaphysically possible. Like, I believe it is metaphysically impossible for you to be possessed while you're carrying energies of light. It just is not possible. The energies are going to block each other. It is impossible for spirits of light to be possessed in your body when you're carrying darkness. It is just metaphysically impossible. It just cannot occur. And it is metaphysically impossible to duplicate the voice of God, even though you might feel that you can do something that God does. It's metaphysically impossible because you are not in the correct vibration. It just cannot occur. So you gotta do the work. That is all it boils down to. You gotta do the work, create the hooks for spirit to attach to. The last thing that I want to advise, it's just my little tidbit. I talked about the fact that you cannot create pentacles from you cannot create cups from pentacles. Cups is emotional fulfillment. That's what I define it as. And pentacles is money and material abundance. If you go to spirit and you want to ask spirit for something, say spirit wants something from you, you're in favor. Don't waste your time asking spirit for pentacles, because they can create pentacles in multiple ways. These are the oldest energies. They don't care about our fiat. They don't care about our currency. It's very silly to them. I mean, it's not silly. They understand that, you know, this is part of enjoying life. But this is not something that they really feel like. It's not hard to create it. Spirit will just give you like a little list. Go do this, go do that. Now bless it, done. What is that? Asking spirit to create cups, that is where the work is. You want to challenge spirit, you ask for cups. I want true love. I want real friendships. I want family that love and support me. That is work. Because now spirit has to get you to be an energetic match to that. Spirit has to find the people that are an energetic match to you. They have to bring you guys together, and they have to keep bringing you guys together until you guys willfully, of your own free will, come together. And therein is the challenge for any spirit, because spirit cannot change the will of another. I don't care what love spell you want to talk about. I don't care what kind of intranquil spirits you want to talk about. I don't care what you want to talk about. You cannot be an energetic match because spirit is forcing you to do so. Spirit can only beg and plead so much. You must do the work. You must do the healing. You must do the changing yourself. You can meet the best, most loving family, and you approach these people in a negative energy, and they will look at you and they will avoid you for the rest of their days because you are not an energetic match. You're not loving. You're not. You can fake it so long, but you will be exposed. And if those people have spirit guides, their guides will block you from them. And everybody should have spirit guides, unless your guides have abandoned you. So this boils down to the same thing every single time: doing the work. If you want to ask God for something, ask God for cups. Do not ask for pentacles. Because once you get the cups, you can create the pentacles anyway. You do the work, you say a prayer, and it'll be blessed. You can create the pentacles from the cups, not the other way around. Also, don't waste your time asking for spiritual gifts, please. Spiritual gifts are so you can be in service. And once you're in service, it's going to come with gifts anyway, without you asking. I'm not saying nobody, but, you know, sitting there and thinking, well, what gift do I want? For what purpose? If it's going to be nefarious, spirit's not going to give it to you anyway, just because, like, I want to see through walls. For what purpose? What is the intention behind this? So I can see people while they're getting undressed. No, you're not getting that. if you are have spiritual favor, the gifts that you're given are supposed to be in the service of God, of the Most High, of the greater good of humanity. You play a role. We all play our roles in this. So, as you're given an assignment, you'll be given also the tools with which to do that. So let's say you connect to the dead, necromancy. Let's say you can read cards, you connect to spirit, you could do this, you could do that. But you're given that for a reason. Just like dark forces will give you spiritual gifts for a reason. And I want you to know that spiritual gifts, you're a custodian, they're on loan. You may not come back next lifetime with this, and they can be taken away. I don't care what anybody tells me, it can be taken away. Your spiritual gifts can be blocked, whether by spirit or whether by whoever else, okay? Or they can attempt it. So I wouldn't bother asking for wands either. I wouldn't bother to ask for that. Ask for the cups, the energy. The energy of love creates everything. It is a very abundant energy. When a person, a family come together and they create something, it is beautiful, it is blessed. And especially when it's being created in the energy of love, it's being created of service. There's no choice but to bless it. It is an energetic match to blessings. It is not always easy on your gang stalking journey. But please walk around in the energy that you wish to be in. Walk around in the energy of the things that you desire. Not easy walking around in the energy of love as people are trying to tear you down. Sometimes I go and I ask God, how am I supposed to help people when every time I try to help people, they're using the information to rip me apart? Balance must be found. I don't know. I don't know everything. I'm still on my walk, but as I evolve, I learn more, I give you guys the truth of what I keep finding. And I am also on a healing journey. And I also try to find the right vibrations as well. I'm not always in them. Sometimes I'm not in good vibrations. Sometimes it's projected to me, but sometimes it's also on my healing path of working through the things that have not been easy for me to go through. Ask spirit for cups. And the pentacles will come after. Take care of yourself, heal yourself, grow yourself. This is my message. Let me do spirit messages card because I always will forget to do this card. Where did this water come from? This is not an easy path. Spiritual life is hard, very hard. If you find yourself stuck in a situation you are unhappy with, ask yourself why you are still there. Is it fear of the unknown? Yes. Leaving toxic situations or people can be the best thing you could do for your soul and your spirit. Be fierce. Leaving gang stalking is going to take work. It's going to take energy. It's going to take a lot of work. But that's okay. The work is what prepares you for the life after. Your life after you allow spirit to put a death to what it is you are going through. And that is okay. Wait a minute, what was that? Okay, well, we'll just see what comes out. And let me see what crystal comes up for me today. By the way, you have energy attacks, you need crystals. Crystals help with absolutely everything. You have no idea. You need crystals. You can't get around it. You cannot get around it. You cannot be a TI without crystals. I'm just gonna go ahead and say it. The crystals block all kinds of energy. They block all kinds of attacks. They heal all kinds of things. They rectify all kinds of things. So get you some crystals. Blue kyanite. The crystal of deep meditative states, prayer, and connecting with spirit. Deep blue kyanite is the ultimate healing, and the vibration is extremely high. amplifying high frequency energies, blue kyanite aligns chakras and subtle bodies, clearing pathways and meridians. This powerful stone grounds and mediates the flow of spiritual energy, restores chi, which is life force, to the physical body and stabilizes the energy bodies and soul after transformation. I'm gonna read that again. This powerful stone grounds and mediates the flow of spiritual energy and restores your life force to your physical body and stabilizes the energy bodies and soul after transformation. You lose a lot of life force going through gang stalking. It's not easy. Kyanite is tranquilizing, inducing deep meditative states, and yet stimulates psychic abilities, facilitating detaching from the idea of blind fate or implacable karma. Blue kyanite reveals measures required to balance out the past. It encourages speaking your highest truth. On the body, it deals with muscular system, temperature control, thyroid, adrenal glands, throat, and brain. And in the mind, it promotes logical thought and overcomes fears. And this is what blue kyanite looks like. And that is it. That is my message of the day. Thank you. And have a great day, and remember that God loves you.